Are you ready to get started with your talk?
Yes, I am. And awesome. I'm going to start with Menti. So you guys may or may not know what Menti is, but I would like you to go to menti.com and enter this code. So you can use your phone. You go to menti.com and you'll enter in 889407. And I'm going to see how many people are joining in the bottom right corner. So my first question to all the viewers is, what is your understanding of machine learning? I just want to get an idea of what you folks know, and I want to compare. So we have some answers on here. I know of it, trying to learn more. I'm a noob. I've made some progress, or it's what I get paid to do. If there's any issues, yay. So for me personally, I wrote that I'm somewhere in between. I've made some progress and it's what I get paid to do. I'm hoping by the time I finish my master's, it'll be a full-time thing. Getting some more bubbles popping up. And Ali, what is your answer to this?
Yeah, sure. My answer was, like, I was a math major in undergrad, but that's a long time ago. So it's something I do know about, but I'm definitely interested in learning more.
That's awesome.
So but I also want to say I really like this interactivity. It's fantastic.
I love Menti. It's like if you ever seen Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, this is just ask your audience. So this is the lifeline. I like getting interactive with the audience just to get them, you know, engaged.
Fantastic.
So this is my first question. My last question, I'm going to skip to it. Sorry, folks, if you didn't get the answer, is do you use version control? So yes, no, and I save files differently to differently labeled folders on my desktop. I am guilty of the third. Ali, I don't know about yourself.
I try to follow software engineering best practices. I even try to do like CI pipelines for my side projects. It's a little bit too much.
So when I was starting with Python, when I was starting with any kind of exploratory data analysis, I'd start with the notebook and I just have all these different ways that I was attacking it. And I just keep saving things to different files on my desktop. So it's really great to see that there are a good amount of folks using version control. So I've started doing that with my Python stuff, and I'll be going into that in just a minute.
Awesome.
Thank you so much, folks, for sharing your answers. You should be seeing my slides now.
Yeah, please take it away. Do you mind clicking the hide for the stop sharing?
Yeah. Nope. Won't let me get to it.
Okay, don't worry about it. We're all good. Haseeb, please take it away.
So my name is Haseeb Mohammed. I'm going to be sharing with you 6 tips for any technologists getting started with machine learning might want to know. A little about myself. I'm a senior software engineer. I specialize in cloud development and machine learning at Polaris Solutions. We specialize in modern software projects for our customers. Currently earning my master's in computer science at Georgia Institute of Technology, specializing in machine learning. You can find me on LinkedIn, Baba Brown Bear, or you can email me, Haseeb@Polaris.llc. So I got to ask the audience, and it looks like there's a good amount of knowledge here. When folks ask me what is machine learning, my go-to answer is, if traditional programming is taking rules and data to get results, then machine learning is taking that data and its results to get a set of rules. So for instance, if you're approving a loan at a bank, traditional programming might have what is your income, how old are you, how long have you had a job, and that'll take all those if-then branches and come up with, okay, we'll approve you for a loan. With machine learning, what you could do is take a data set of labeled approved loans and denied loans, run that through a model, and you'll get back a model that will tell you whether or not a person should be approved or denied with some percentage of probability. So that's my go-to answer for what is machine learning. First thing I want to share with you guys is, thankfully, William covered it, Jupyter notebooks are awesome, but VS Code takes it to another level. So what I found the least amount of friction to get started with Jupyter notebooks is Google Colab. Just pop it open, log in with your Gmail account, and you have a notebook ready to go. But we can take that a step further with VS Code. So here's VS Code. I'm hoping a lot of you folks know this already. I'm going to just zoom in a little bit on each of the sides. On the left, we have our list of files. And in the middle, we have the Python file that we're actually running. At the very bottom is our integrated terminal, where I can run the actual script file that I'm writing at the same time. And I can see the output. For instance, here, I'm doing a .head to show the top 5 results of my data frame. What's awesome about VS Code is that there is an integrated Jupyter notebook where I can shift enter some amount of code and it'll bring it over to this write terminal and show Jupyter notebook cells executed. And I can continue my any kind of exploratory data analysis on this write side. What I can do then is if I write anything of significance, I can just copy that code into my Python file and then I can commit that Python file into version control. That way I can keep all my toying and exploring in Jupyter notebooks, not have to worry about it. And then anything I want to keep, just drop it in a Python file and commit it. So that's my workflow. That way my diffs look clean. I know William brought that up and it's, for me, it's cleaner to do this. So number 2, scientists keep an experiment log. So do chefs and so should we. So with this quarantine, I've been watching too many cooking shows on YouTube, and what some chefs will do is they'll start with, oh, I used to do this recipe with just this much salt, or I tried brown sugar, or I tried dark sugar, and it came out this way. What they'll do is they'll write down in their notebook all the different types of recipes that they tried and the results of them. So they know, oh, last time I used too much salt, I need to adjust it so I can get a better recipe this time. The code I'm going to be walking through here is on dev.2. You can Google Bobber Brown Bear making money with ML. And what I'm going to be showing you is the Azure ML VS Code extension. So the Azure ML VS Code extension and the Python SDK that they provide gives you access to a function called run.log. Now what run.log does is it'll output the value of that parameter into a dashboard on Azure ML. So for instance, I'm outputting all these different parameters for a model that I'm running below in this file, and I want to see the output of this file on Azure ML. So these are all the parameters for the model. And then this is what I'm using to gauge the success of my model. So at the very end of my file, I'm saying, how much money did this model actually make? What I can do with this file is I can then run it as an experiment in Azure with that extension. And then what I can do further is I can continue to tweak each parameter and repeat the last run. And I'll keep running the same thing as the same experiment in Azure, and I'll get to see the output of different runs. I won't need to use my local. I can just say, queue up 10 of these different parameter changes, and I can run it on it and see the results in Azure ML. So this is Azure ML. This is the dashboard for the experiment that I was running. At the bottom, you'll see two runs, run 2 and run 3. Run 2 made $9,300. Run 3 made $13,000. And I can see the difference between the two runs is the number of estimators that I used. So between run 2 and 3, I added 100 and estimators. Now I know, okay, let me continue to increase those estimators till I get to a point where I'm not making any more money. And then I can start with the other parameters as well to see if I can keep tweaking that to get a better result. And I can get all this clean output on the dashboard for Azure ML. Number 3, the GPU on my MacBook Pro cannot run PyTorch. What I wanted to do this year was learn deep learning. And I had thought that my very nice MacBook Pro, I could run the PyTorch on it and I'll have faster execution by using the GPU. That's not the case. PyTorch has a accessibility matrix for what GPUs can and cannot run on it, and mine was not compatible. So what I did instead was use Google Colab and switch the notebook settings to use a GPU. And that's how I ran most of my deep learning stuff that I did this year. What you can do instead, so again, this is for a notebook, but when I'm running Python files and I want to run it, I will use Azure ML's remote compute instances. So on Azure ML, I can create a remote run, a remote compute instance, and I can set it to a GPU. So over here, I'm generating a GPU with 12 cores, 2 GPUs, a whole lot of RAM, and a whole lot of disk space. Now I can write my models in a regular Python script and then send it up to Azure ML to run remotely, and I won't need to use the CPU on my MacBook and not let it overheat. Number four, moving data between scripts doesn't need to be in CSVs. So I have a software engineering background. I like a lot of separation of concern. When I'm writing my Python files, I'll write one for cleaning my data, one for running the training model, one for running the validation script, and then one for any kind of visualizations. What I was doing was wrong. What I was doing was saving my data as CSVs and importing and exporting between each of the files. What I had to do then as well was trim down the number of decimals that I was writing to. Instead, I started using Pickles this year, and it saves your data frame as a physical file on your data system, and you can just import that pickle and you'll have access to that variable in your script without losing any accuracy. So over here, there's some sample code from Pandas on how to create a pickle and then how to read the pickle in a new file. So then once I started using that between my files, instead of saving it as a CSV, I saw a much better increase in precision and accuracy. Number five. All right, so I've been running a model. I've been tweaking this. I maybe have run a dozen different kinds of parameters on my model, and it's still not giving me the results I want. Maybe 13,000 is not the amount of money that I want to do. Maybe I want to get to 100,000. But now I have to start all this over again with a new model. That's time consuming, and I don't have a lot of time. So what I'm proposing to you instead is automate the initial model finding. If you have your clean data set, just use Azure ML's automated ML, select the target column you're attempting to predict, select your remote compute instance, and just let it go. What it's going to do is it's going to run dozens, if not hundreds, of different models and try to come up with an accuracy for you, the best possible accuracy. So this is just the top 7-8 runs of a model I did. It ended up doing about 50 runs. And it found that a voting ensemble for my data set would give the most accuracy. Just on these 7 runs alone, it jumped from 65% to 83%. Now, this model, I would say you take it and then you tweak it further and try to get that 83% up even higher by just playing with the different parameters of that model. Number six, don't be afraid of failure. The only reason I'm here is because I made thousands of mistakes and you learn from them. You just be consistent. You just keep learning and it's okay to fail. That's the only way you are going to learn. I'm happy to chat more. Go ahead and email me, Haseeb@Polaris.llc. I'll also be in the Slack if you want to hit me up over there. Thank you so much.
Awesome. Can we get a round of applause for Haseeb and that awesome talk? So while we are waiting for questions to come in, I think we actually have one question. I'm not too sure if you're familiar with the ML Flow tool. Is Azure ML like ML Flow?
I have not used an ML Flow tool, but if I understand you correctly, you can use that to get your models into production. So you can write a model, it'll save it and output it, and you can create it as an API endpoint on Azure ML.
Okay, awesome. And just while we're waiting for questions to come in, call out back to our discussion question of the night. Do you have like a favorite like data science tool that you can like recommend to people?
So I've been using Pandas since I started, but I have a place in my heart for just SQL. Like I've been using SQL ever since I graduated with my bachelor's, and my entire professional career is just using SQL. If I can get anything into a relational database model, I'll use it that way. So when I first started Python and Pandas, I didn't understand Pandas. I didn't understand what was going on in the data frame. So I just took my data set, imported it into SQL, did whatever I wanted to do, outputted it back out. And then I ran my Python script because I was like, I don't have time to learn Pandas. I already know what I have to do in SQL. Let's just do that. But since then I've grown and I've learned to use Pandas a bit more.
Yeah, Pandas is a fantastic tool, but I think like SQL, you can use it for anything. It's like pretty much any problem could be solved with the relational database. And just knowing a little bit about that, like can like put you so far ahead as a data scientist. Do you have any tips or any tips on learning SQL?
SQLBolt.com. That's my go-to resource for whenever someone says, hey, I want to learn SQL. I did not write it. I'm not associated with them, but I've been pitching that to anyone who wants to learn SQL. I'll drop that link in the Slack.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, that would be great. I was looking for... Yeah, we just got a question. And so... Do you know about like the cost prohibitiveness of like Azure ML versus like training models on a desktop?
So I maybe ran 500 models on Azure ML so far, and I spent $5. I've run deep learning models. I've run regular machine learning models. It doesn't break the bank, and they give you $150 credit when you sign up. They want to get people onto the system. So it's really cheap to use, especially right now, and you can get access to credits almost always.
Awesome. And we are not sponsored right now, but Microsoft, if you are listening, we are open for video sponsorship. Thanks again, Haseeb. Before we let you go, do you have any call to actions for our community?
No call to action, but any questions, please email me. I'm happy to chat.
Awesome. And thank you so much for making yourself available to our community. And hope to see you again on the Slack.
Thanks. Have a good one.